So right now, it would be traditional at a conference when introducing such a guest to say that he requires no introduction and then to go ahead and introduce him anyway, which I shall do. I don't think it would be an abuse of the language to describe Norman Davies as a legend of European history writing. Professor Davies has been an honorary fellow of St. Anthony's College, Oxford, since 2011. He is Professor Emeritus of UCL CEIS and an honorary fellow of Clare Hall here in Cambridge, and a life member also of Peterhouse College in Cambridge. Until 2012, he was UNESCO professor at the Jagiellonian University in Kraków. In 2012, he was granted Poland's highest civilian award, the Order of the White Eagle. He was educated at Magdalen College, Oxford, the University of Sussex, and the Jagiellonian University in Kraków. His many publications include White Eagle, Red Star, the Polish-Soviet War of 1919-1920, God's Playground, A History of Poland, Heart of Europe, The Past in Poland's Present, Europe, A History, The Isles, A History, Rising 44, The Battle for Warsaw, and most recently, Vanished Kingdoms, The History of Half-Forgotten Europe, published in 2013. Today, Professor Davies is going to just give a few informal remarks about historical narratives and the problems with the uses of historical narratives. And after that, we'll open the floor to some questions and discussions. So I would like to welcome to the stage Professor Norman Davies.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for those kind words. I was dismayed when I saw that my name had made it to the program of the conference. I tried to argue with Stanley Bill that owing to old age, infirmity, and a feeble mind, I was no longer capable of talking to a conference like this. Stanley, as you know, is not a person to listen to spurious arguments. And he put me on the conference program, notwithstanding. What he did, mercifully, was to limit my time to 15 or 20 minutes. I don't have a script, and I shall follow an idea which we talked about a few weeks ago, which arose from a well-known quotation from a 19th century Cracovian historian, Józef Szulski, to the effect that false history is the mother of false politics. The actual quotation is falszywa historia mistrzynia, mistress, falszywej polityki. Szulski was one of the leading lights of a group of historians in Kraków in the western part of the Galicia we saw on the film the other night, very critical of Poland's past. And they call themselves the Stanczyk group. Stanczyk was the joker of King Sigmund the old, Stary. And he was, of course, the only person in the royal court who was permitted to speak his mind without reprimand. And when I'm approached, as happens quite often, by journalists with pompous questions, such as, who is your hero in Polish history? And they expect a reply of, I don't know, Joseph Piłsudski or Tadeusz Kościuszko or Lech Kaczyński. I always say, Stańczyk. It's the safest. And I think the most honest reply to such questions. False history includes a multitude of sins, including, of course, false nomenclature, about which I could easily give an hour's impromptu lecture. It struck me the other day, or was it yesterday, there was mention of the partitions of Poland, 1773 to 1795. And of course, it wasn't Poland that was being partitioned in the 18th century. It was, glad to see Robert nodding in approval, the Commonwealth of Poland-Lithuania. And Poland was the Korona, which included a very large chunk of Ukraine, and Lithuania included, of course, much more than modern Lithuania. Now, to give you just a few, two or three examples of false history and the unfortunate consequences of it, I thought over breakfast of three examples. The first one comes from 1920, May 1920, and the Polish-Soviet War, which was the subject of the first book that I wrote as a young historian. And in May 1920, the Polish army under Marshal Piłsudski, in alliance with the Ukrainian forces of Petlura, launched an offensive against Kiev. Kiev at the time was occupied by the Bolsheviks, but was officially the capital of Ukraine, which had declared its independence in 1918. This offensive, however, provoked a worldwide campaign denouncing this military action on the grounds that it was directed against Russia. And the slogan of the day was, hands off Russia. The future Foreign Minister of Great Britain, Ernest Bevin, who in 1920 was a trade union leader, led a major strike in London docks to prevent military aid being sent to Poland and, one might say indirectly, to the Ukrainian cause as well. And Bevin's slogan was, hands off Russia. Right. In other words, they got their geography and their history all mangled up, the strike action in various parts of Europe in May and June 1920 was actually quite effective. Very little aid reached Poland, let alone Ukraine, because of the strike in Britain, the blockade of shipping going to Poland, and strikes in Czechoslovakia and elsewhere. But that was, as it were, just one example which came to mind of the way that a false understanding of geography and history can have very serious effects. A second example I thought of comes from September 1939, in the first month of the Second World War. As I'm sure everybody in this room knows, the German Wehrmacht attacked Poland on the 1st of September from the west, and Stalin's Red Army invaded Poland on the 17th of September from the east. And at the time of the Soviet invasion, the former Prime Minister of Great Britain, David Lloyd George, wrote a large article in the press which condemned the German attack as evil, nefarious, dangerous, every bad adjective you think, whilst expressing understanding for the Soviet invasion. As a result, the Polish ambassador in London, Count Raczynski, from whom I heard the story that I'm now telling laboriously, Count Raczynski wrote a reply to the Times newspaper countering the assertions that David Lloyd George had made in support of the Soviet invasion of Eastern Poland. His letter was not published. In fact, he spent the rest of September trying in vain to publish a balanced account of what Eastern Poland was and who lived there. Instead, the Times published a letter from the leading academic of the London University, the School of Slavonic Studies, Sir Bernard Pears. Thank you, Robert. Bernard Pears was an established historian of Russia. He had close links with the Cadet Party, the, as it were, constitutional liberal element in Russian politics. And he wrote, as it were, the definitive answer to the protests that the Polish ambassador was trying to make. And he wrote a letter, Bernard Pears wrote a letter saying the population of Eastern Poland is Russian. That's what he said, Russian. Let alone distinctions between Belarusians, Ukrainians, Poles, Lithuanians, Jews, and so on. This was the chief academic authority of Great Britain in 1939, pronouncing that the population of Eastern Poland was Russian. Therefore, Stalin's invasion and the specious explanation that the Soviets gave was genuine. And I have to say, the Polish ambassador, thanks to British war censorship, was never able to publish a more reasoned description of what Eastern Poland was, who lived there, and so on. All he was able to do, and he told me himself with great difficulty, was to publish privately a brochure which summarized the article which he had failed to introduce to the British press. But that tells you a great deal about all sorts of things, not just about false history, but also about Western attitudes and misinformation, disinformation, and the confusion that often prevails in the West over events in the East. Now, it struck me that this question of false history is a major theme when we try to understand what is happening in the present day in the conflict between Russia and Ukraine. There are all sorts of causes one could talk about, but I think an underlying current is a basic conflict of historical understanding as to what Ukraine is, what its history is, and what its true connections with its Russian and Polish neighbors are. And to an extent, this applies very much to Mr. Putin. Are we to think of Mr. Putin simply as a bad man with evil designs who is conspiring nefariously to undermine the existing order? Or is he perhaps a misguided person who is simply who has simply swallowed various concepts, including historical concepts, about Russia and Ukraine and places connected with the present conflict? One should remember that Mr. Putin has a first name, Vladimir. Saint Vladimir was christened, I believe, in Hersonesos in Crimea. And it could be, I never asked him, but that Vladimir Putin was told as a small boy that he was stepping into the shoes of the great Saint, Russian Saint Vladimir of Crimea, and hence, emotionally, he is somehow disposed to thinking of this peninsula as his own. And I think I would tend to this second explanation, namely that Vladimir Putin has swallowed, either consciously or unconsciously, a number of historical falsifications which drive his policy no less, as it were, than cynical political calculations. And I think there are two sorts of historical concepts that one can see in or behind what Mr. Putin has done and says about Ukraine. One is, as it were, what Khrushchevsky called the Russian scheme of history, the Russian version of history. Going back hundreds of years, and including such things as Kiev as the cradle of Russian civilization, the Third Rome, the gathering of the lands, all the things that if you do Russian history in many British or American universities, you'd be told as the Bible truth of everything that happens. The other element is derives from Soviet propaganda. And most prominently, the official view of the Second World War as proclaimed in Moscow. Of course, they don't talk about the Second World War very carefully. They talk about the Great Fatherland War, which conveniently begins in 1941 and enables them not to talk about all the things that happened in 1939 or 1940 or early 41. And these two strands come out, either, if you like, the Muscovite ideology, which goes back at least to the 15th century. Very closely connected in its early days with the Russian Orthodox Church and the claims of the Moscow Patriarch to lands beyond the Muscovite state. That is one element. Mr. Putin, as you know, has embraced the Russian Orthodox Church, and he's no doubt received a dose of the old ideology to go with it. The other strand, the Soviet dialectical view of the Great Fatherland War, is also very strong. This is behind the, as it were, the knee-jerk reaction to classify anybody who opposes Russia as a fascist. Putin has done it repeatedly. He doesn't like the leaders in Ukraine, so he calls them fascists. At many points in the 20th century, you see that people desperately pleading with the Russian, their Russian allies, during the Second World War, you know, why do you call us fascists? You know, is everybody who has a slightly different view on the world from you a fascist? It's as old as the hills. And it comes out, and whether Mr. Putin repeats it simply for political convenience or because I suspect it's, as it were, ingrained in his worldview as taught by the KGB and others, it's there. Which brings me to, as it were, the ultimate distortion of history, which was put into apparently Russian law in 2013. This is a wondering whether to call it a law, edict, at least, or a resolution from the Duma. That the Soviet victory in 1945 is sacred. Sacred. In other words, this is an instrument which can be used to condemn legally, to punish anybody who denies or insults, as they would say, the great Soviet victory of 1945. This is the, you know, ultimate suppression, as it were, of free speech. Earlier this year, I actually went to Moscow, not knowing about this resolution, which was already in being, and I delivered a lecture called Who Won the Second World War? And I now realize that I could have well been pursued by the authorities for daring to question the sacred truth. And I have to say, when I said my piece, a woman, a director of some distinguished Moscow historical interest, stood up and said very indignantly, "Don't you know that that our view of," doesn't say this, "that our view of the Great Fatherland War is sacred?" In other words, what are you, on earth are you doing, daring to come here and wanting to discuss it? There is nothing to discuss. We know what happened, and please don't insult us by daring to make some weak jokes about it. I'd started my lecture by saying I didn't think that the British Empire won the Second World War, and I didn't think that Poland had won the Second World War. and I didn't think that the United States had won the war in Europe, although the United States clearly won the war in the Pacific, and so on. But I realized that I was treading on very thin ice by treating this subject as something to discuss. And that, unfortunately, is the world we live in. And the closed minds of people that rule Russia are, of course, one of the major obstacles to a sensible policy of dealing with them. Which ends my impromptu introduction of the subject. If somebody can save the proceedings by asking a question, I'd be very relieved.
Thank you very much, Professor Davies, for an extremely important set of remarks, I think in part because of how relevant they remain today. British public intellectuals and politicians with a very limited understanding of the part of the world that this conference is about, Central and Eastern Europe. Another interesting question that was raised that might be one of the tricky questions that we could get to talk about later is, of course, this problem of the legislation of history and how that might bear upon our discussion here today, which obviously is an important issue. We have a microphone running around. Could you raise your hand if you have a question for Professor Davies? For Robert Frost.
Yes, well, thank you, Norman. Characteristically trenchant and amusing. What you say about Lloyd George and the British public intellectuals of the 1930s, as Stan has said, remains true of their reaction to the current crisis. In the current crisis, of course, we are also dealing with a historical profession who has taken on board the seductive idea of postmodernism that all accounts of history are equally valid. And therefore, as I say to my students when I teach this, all that you can study is historiography, at which point they run for the exits. We have to hold on to the idea that history does deal with something that happened and was truthful, as Sir Richard Evans, late of these parts, trenchantly argued in his book In Defense of History. But we have to defend history and proper history of Eastern Europe against that seduction of the classes taught by Russianists and, dare I say it, with Brendan Sims sitting in the front row, by Germanists about the history of the bit of Europe in between. The story of the partitioning powers and the justification for that history that they've been making since the 18th century. It was the Prussians, deliberately in the late 18th century, who invented the concept of Polnische Wirtschaft that they used to denigrate the Polish, we heard about this yesterday, denigrate the Polish system. Meanwhile, Frederick the Great was flooding Poland with debased coins so he could say, ah, look, you haven't got an economy. But in reacting to what goes on in Ukraine, I myself have tried to fight on various fronts this idea that we have to understand Russia, which was said in the, you know, Russia's position in this. It's the international relations as a game of chess, devoid from the people involved. Russia is a great power. America is a great power. And of course, America is now demonized as an imperial power by many American intellectuals, by many British intellectuals. And somehow this excuses what Russia does. I had a letter published in the Times where I asked why the BBC was not sending camera crews to Lviv in Western Ukraine to talk with ordinary Ukrainians. But every night on the news, we had interviews with people on the streets of Donetsk talking about the dreadful effect of shells falling on them, which is appalling. But the amount of times we were allowed to see somebody giving the Ukrainian point of view was minimal. Every day on the Today program, every morning you had Russia Today giving the Russian version, and you very rarely had anybody speaking for Ukraine. I had an exchange of letters with a eminent QC who wrote a letter in the Times saying we must understand the Russian position and basically hand over anything that they want. And he waxed lyrical in reply to me about how he remembered in his primary school sitting there in London during the war with pictures of Stalin on the wall and how Stalin had saved Europe. And that is what, that, there's a continuity from Lloyd George on. It was you in God's Playground who pointed, was it his remark about I'd rather give a clock to a monkey than Upper Silesia to Poland?
Upper Silesia, 1921.
That's an attitude. It remains entrenched. I pointed out in another place that, you know, look at, you regard Ukraine as naturally part of Russia. I pointed out that Alaska was ruled by Russia for longer than Lviv was ruled by Russia. You know, but they don't say, let's give Alaska back to Russia. Thank you.
We'll just gather maybe a couple more questions and then give Norman
if
and
I could
Davies
just comment that Robert has been well trained somewhere at some point.
I have actually a similar comment or question. Namely, I'm really impressed by your lecture, but could you characterize the current situation among, let's say, academic scholars dealing with Russia? How strong are they, in your opinion, in Britain and the United States, influenced by the, let's say, traditional vision of Russian history and by Russian claims?
Maybe one more question here.
If I have to remember
Frank
questions,
and then Alenka.
Why
don't you answer those two, and then we'll go on to Frank and Alenka.
I've already forgotten the first one, which was.
Was there a question there, Rob?
No.
Was it a comment?
It was
Wukash's question.
Yeah.
If I may just add to that question, because it follows on that, is we offer. I'm interested in how you can think about changing courses that we offer here. For example, introductions to Russian culture, since they tend to begin with the medieval period and therefore include everything within the framework of Russian history, even though they're introductory courses within the Slavonic departments. So I'm wondering if you have a thought on how it is possible to change this framework so that medieval history is not immediately associated with Russian identity or cultural identity.
Okay. Where do I start? The Russians have had a good start on everybody in this. They've been, as I suggested, selling their historical wares for at least 600 or 700 years. And there's a huge inertia built into the institutions which promote knowledge, history, and so on. I have to say that Cambridge Department of Slavonic Studies seems to be a wonderful exception to all of this, that it's certainly moving against the trend to have a department which has Russian, Ukrainian, and now Polish studies flourishing within it. And this is exactly the pluralistic context which helps sensible views of history to flourish. Traditionally, Slavonic departments have been the enemy of pluralist views. If I dare mention the great University of Stanford in California, some years before we were there, but circa 1980, the Slavic department of Stanford had a democratic vote whether or not to abolish all subjects other than Russian. And of course, democratically, they wiped out all studies of Poland, Czechoslovakia, Yugoslavia, and so on. And when we arrived there, the former professors of Stanford University were working in the local bookshop. a monopoly of Russian views of the Slavonic world had been established democratically. So that's the sort of thing that we are struggling against. And it's not only a question of ill will. There are, and we all come across them from time to time, advocates of whatever, Joseph Stalin or you know, Soviet views of the world, Russian views of the world. There are such people. But Robert touched on this very other interesting problem, the idea that all views are equally valid. And students, I'm afraid, very often live in this world where they can judge a question as they think fit, and any conclusion is as good as another. And the judgment is not whether their conclusion is based on an analysis of the facts, but whether or not they have made an effort to analyze the problem in any way they like. And how do we oppose this? Well, one thing is by holding conferences like this. I think we're seeds are being planted, which are hopeful for the future. But we've had a particularly bad period since 1989 for the study of our area. Oddly enough, during the Cold War, and this applies particularly in the United States, governments were quite happy to subsidize departments of Slavonic, East European, Russian, Soviet things. And since the Cold War, this major source of funding and encouragement has dwindled. At the institution where I was professor until 1996, we had 8 people in post teaching about Poland. We could lay on a decent undergraduate and graduate courses in interdisciplinary study of Poland. Now, if I'm not mistaken, of those 8 posts, there's 1.5. It may be 2, I don't know. Yeah. And there's one person on 5 years leave, which you might count or might not count. Okay. But, you know, it definitely less than half, if not down to a quarter of what it used to be. And we are struggling, a group of like-minded people, struggling to establish or re-establish these studies in a viable way. And I have to say the Cambridge component of that struggle is extremely promising. Of course, one of the antidotes is to have as many people from these countries, from Ukraine, from Poland, from Baltic states, wherever, to let them come here, support their presence, and they know how to counter these arguments better than anybody else. The problem is that many Westerners have never heard anything other than the Russian version of history. Go to the Cambridge University bookshop and look at some of the books which are on sale. They are talking about the Russian version of history.
I think we've got time for a question from Frank Sisson.
Yeah, maybe a short comment, a view from across the Atlantic. Although you describe Stanford, I think, quite aptly for 1980, at least in the last 2 years, the situation as far as media and government has been quite different in North America from Britain and Europe. That is, if one looks, I think, and Sarie Polkey can comment as well, Canada obviously is, let's say, the full exception in that case, and there I would attribute it largely to the size of the Ukrainian diaspora community in Canada. But if one looks at the major Canadian news media, certainly the government policy, fairly clearly pro-Ukraine, Ukrainian position comes through strongly, complaints particularly by the Russian community of Canada that they are being discriminated against. So this is the picture there. Not uniform, but generally. But even looking at the more important American media, I would think that both sides were presented, and probably the winning side was the pro-Ukrainian side, as far as media reported, changed in various periods. Academia is somewhat different. And what I have noticed is a certain silence by my colleagues in Russian studies. That is not that they say, I mean, Stephen Cohen can get up and say the most foolish things all the time, of course, and he is used all the time on the media, but most have been rather silent. The political scientists have come down on various sides of this issue, but Ukraine and the Ukrainian position has been fairly well represented with certain sympathy. Now, one can argue this is because the U.S. is the Cold Warrior and it's the empire and all of these other reasons, and this is what Stephen Cohen would say. Historians have largely been deafeningly silent. That is, the historians of Russia. They don't want to deal with it, but they don't deal with it badly. So that's the comment.
But they don't know how to deal with it.
They don't know how.
That's right.
Now, but the question part is, we know what the Ukrainian start position was, as you outlined from 1939, which was nowhere minus in these issues. And at a certain level, indeed, we can say since 1989, Ukrainian studies has increased, knowledge of Ukraine has increased, the number of universities teaching Ukrainian has increased. What I'm much more puzzled is your account, and I think it is a bit too dark, and your own work has done much to, I think, bring light to many people, but why the Polish studies case and Poland has not made a better case for itself. And particularly in Britain, I would argue in North America, the Polish case is understood better, but probably not commensurate with where it should be. Mm-hmm. And what your views are on why of all things, rather successful Poland with a long-term tradition has this problem at the moment.
We've got time very quickly to collect Andrzej Szeptycki's question, and then we'll allow Norman to answer and conclude. We'll go a little over time because we started late. Just brief question, if you could.
Yeah. Well, there is, of course, let's say, this competition of the Russian vision of history and Central European, but there is as well, we've talked about that yesterday, the competition between Polish and Ukrainian vision of history. Somebody yesterday said it is a logic of freedom on one side, as far as I remember, the Polish vision, and suffering on the other. Mm-hmm. So if you take, let's say, one of the leading Western scholars on Ukraine, historians, Daniel Beauvoir, he clearly supports the suffering version, speaking about even post-colonialism quasi-colonial Polish policy towards Kresy. So my question to you, I hope you don't mind if I call you like that, my question to you as a leading Western scholar on Poland, is which of these two versions would you support?
Sorry, I can't even write down the notes.
Robert promises he has a very short question.
One of the problems, and it's my own career, just to say on my own career, when I did my doctorate under Norman at Thies, people said, you're going to get a job in Polish history. And I said, no, I'm a European historian who happens to research Polish history. And so I've spent my life teaching European history. And one of the problems is that Polish history, Ukrainian history, are put into ghettos of Slavonic studies. And part of what I would like to do with Polish studies is to say, we've got to get enough material out in English so that you can teach Polish sensibly within a general course of European history, so that Poland and Ukraine are present, and we're beginning to reach that stage.
Well, thank you very much. That's a lead-in to the question Frank raised about the paradox that Poland has a reputation, at least, of doing quite well in the last 25 years, and yet interest in Poland in Western academes seems to have shrunk. And it could well be that good news is no news. If there was an insurrection in Poland, if one of these really mad politicians gets in control of Poland and does something, you know, really stupid, the world will wake up and take an interest. But this boring story of Poland's GDP rising at whatever it is, 7% annually, it's crushingly uninteresting. One of the curiosities of the present state of affairs in Poland is, as it were, the objective statistical reality of what has happened in the last 20 years bears no relation to the subjective feelings, especially of young people, about it. I got into an argument with a young woman in a photo shop in Oxford recently about the elections, and I was stupidly saying, well, you know, droga pani, what, can't you understand what things were like in, you know, before 1989? The answer was, she'd no idea what happened before 1989. Her timeline started about 2005. And it's no good old folks like me talking about the People's Republic and people waiting 5 hours in a queue for a loaf of bread or standing for 3 days in line to get 10 litres of petrol. It's of no interest to the younger generation at all. They have quite different points of reference to what people of our age have. Yes, Polish studies. Robert and I and one or two others are trying to do something about this, and we think that the renaissance of Polish studies will be achieved by two things. One is by pooling resources, and the second is by adopting a regional approach, where Polish Ukrainian, Polish German, Polish Jewish, Polish Russian, Polish Czech, whatever, a regional approach which will fit much more comfortably into the framework of European studies. Just to finish about academe, there are in Britain at the moment a score of universities, if not more, where European studies exist. And not one of them have a module about our part of the world, about Poland or Eastern Europe. European studies remain absolutely purely Western European. And that's one of the barriers that we're trying to break. Now, as I've almost forgotten the other very difficult question. the Polish colonial view, or the view of suffering. I don't think I am any more or less objective or subjective than other people. My wife's family came from Lvov, so as it were, by default, I hear a number of views on issues which would be closer to the suffering view of that. I've just finished a book, or rather a big photographic album about the Andes Army, where these issues come, the issues of nationality come up, are very prominent, because as you probably know, the NKVD wouldn't, or tried to prevent Ukrainians, Belarusians and Jews from joining the Andes Army, and Anders successfully got around this business. My view is I think dominated by the realization that the Kresy, this Polish Eastern history, it is history. It's gone. I think I'm going to come to Cambridge in the autumn with I'm going to propose talking about the Andes Army. And the talk will be something like the wandering legions of a lost world, right? This Eastern Polish world, the Kresy, have passed into history. And although there are still people who remember it, sometimes very fondly, sometimes not so fondly, they have no politics, as it were, based on revenge, return, or revision of the post-war order. All this has passed into history, which is creates, I think, a good platform for people to discuss it without too much emotion. So that's half an answer, but I very much agree. There is a colonial streak. Remark, but there's a colleague of mine in Oxford who was applying for an enormous grant, you know, millions of pounds for on imperialism. And I suggested, how about imperialism in Europe? And blank stare. Imperialism, for most people, thinks of European imperialism in the rest of the world, Africa, India, China, or whatever. And, you know, what are you talking about? I said, well, half of Europe gives you wonderful examples of imperialism and colonialism. He said, what do you mean? I said, well, have you not heard Mr. Putin talking about Nowa Rossiya? And how about the Polish expansion into the East, 16th century, major colonial program of settling lands in Ukraine, which to that point were largely not settled. So I absolutely agree there is an imperial colonial story in there, but I think it's only part of the whole. Like the overwhelming, crushing fact is that everybody in what Tim Snyder very tellingly called the Bloodlands suffered appallingly, so that no one of these peoples has a right to talk about their suffering and to forget that of others. Thank you.
Thank you very much for a wonderful presentation.